Good evening. Hey, I didn't do anything. I don't know why you're applauding. I'm not Misty Copeland. I'm Septime Weber, Artistic Director of Halcyon Stage, and I'm so excited to welcome you here tonight. This is an auspicious evening. This is actually the premiere, the first program of Halcyon Stage, and it's exciting to share this evening with you. I want to acknowledge a few colleagues who are in the room. I want to acknowledge the vision of Dr. Sachiko Kuno, the co-founder of SNR Foundation, and my colleague. The mission of the SNR Foundation is to catalyze emerging creatives seeking a better world. And so I appreciate that and really have bought into this amazing vision, so thank you. I also want to acknowledge Kate Goodall, my colleagues Kate Goodall and Jeremy Ney and David Corson and the whole team that I've been working with over the last many, many months. So thank you very much, Kate, and all the other people making this work well. And lots of other sort of stakeholders in our work. David and Sage, thank you very much, and everyone else. I'm thrilled that Misty is our first program because Misty Copeland has been the shatterer of many, of multiple glass ceilings. In 2015, she made history when she became the first African-American principal dancer at American Ballet Theatre, the nation's foremost classical company. A few months before that, also in 2015, Misty shattered another glass ceiling when she danced with the Washington Ballet, when she and Brooklyn Mack performed Swan Lake with the Washington Ballet and Evermay Chamber, a program of SNR Foundation. It was just mind-boggling that 50 years after Brown versus the Board of Education, there was still this kind of glass ceiling. But this was the first time that two African-Americans danced together in the full-length Swan Lake in any major ballet company in the world. So that was another glass ceiling. And she also, if that weren't enough, many credit her with bringing ballet dancers back to celebrity-dom. In fact, she has become a household name in the way that few dancers have become since Mikhail Berzhnikov. And with that, I'd like to introduce Misty Copeland. Misty, come on down. Where is she? Here, you're gonna be on the side.
Hi. Thank you for coming out tonight. Sorry I didn't make it here last night.
ballet performances usually start 5 minutes late. This is a record 24 hours and 5 minutes. Thanks, Misty. Where were you last night?
I was sitting on a train in New York City for like 4 hours. I got in really late, so.
Well, it's great to have you here. We have so much to talk about, past and future, but I really want to start by living in the moment.
Okay.
And you're here in town this week dancing Swan Lake.
Yes.
And you, of course, I was honored to be part of your first American Swan Lake at Washington Ballet at the Kennedy Center, and then was excited that you had so much success at American Ballet Theatre with Swan Lake a couple of months later at the Met. Can you talk about your relationship with the role, and is it different now than it was 2 years ago, or is it still nerve-wracking?
Well, I first have to just credit you, because I think that you have such an eye and your creativity and willingness to kind of step out there and do things like that, like give me an opportunity to do Swan Lake before I was ever cast in Swan Lake at ABT. And so I feel like that's what really got the ball rolling, was you kind of putting that in people's ears. So the first time that I actually ended up performing the role was in Australia, and I think having been in American Ballet Theatre for, I think it was maybe 14 years before I was given an opportunity to do the role of Odette Odile. And with all of that time, you know, spent in the court of ballet and spent as a soloist, you just don't ever expect that you will ever do that role. So for me, it was like, I knew the court of ballet in and out, and I knew, you know, the little swans and pas de trois. So when I was told I was going to be doing this role, it was just, even up until the moment of my first dress rehearsal in Australia, it just wasn't real. It felt like this weird nightmare almost, like, I'm not supposed to be here. I'm supposed to be getting ready for Little Swans, and why am I dressed as Odette? Like, this very surreal feeling. By the time the show came, I felt like I just became her. And it changes with each performance. I feel like when I got to the Washington Ballet, you know, it was a different production. It was Kirk Peterson's production of it, and it was really technically difficult, and I feel like it challenged me in a different way, more technically and physically. And then getting to do it again in the spring season, and now I've done it a couple of times with ABT. Each time I do it, it's a new challenge, and I think that I'm continuing to understand, the older I get and the more experience I have as a principal dancer and doing other roles, the value and the importance and the artistry of taking on these characters. It's something that I've talked to Kevin McKenzie with about a lot, is that it's not, he just says, forget the effing fouettes. You know, like, I think that so many dancers get so caught up in those technicalities and what has become expected instead of embodying these roles. And you think of, you know, Natalia Makarva and even Julie Kent and Susan Jaffe, and these people are artists that embody her. And so that's just, I think, always my goal.
Sure. Because Swan Lake, somehow, it's got the weight of the, you know, of the ballet history behind it. And somehow we all think of it as the Hamlet of ballet. Mm-hmm. Are you, when you go on stage, do you have, like, did you initially start thinking about other interpretations and sort of stealing from the best? Or have you tried to, like, what's it like to walk into those other people's shoes? And is that intimidating?
I think in the beginning, that definitely was what kind of held me back, was feeling that I needed to fill those shoes. And I think what separates us as individuals and as artists is what we bring of ourselves to these roles. It's not about doing exactly what someone else did before you. That would be so boring. Mm-hmm. Why would someone want to come see you try and do what someone already achieved and did very well?
Sure.
I think for me, a lot of it has been accepting and embracing that a black woman can be the Swan Queen, which, you know, in your subconscious and it just psychologically can weigh you down when you just, for your entire training and career, have never seen a black woman, I mean, out there that you can go on YouTube and find or images of. It kind of you know, tears away at you, but it's a love-hate relationship I have with the Swan Queen.
Since you brought it up, the black woman dancing Swan Lake, I'll ask you more broadly about being an African-American ballerina. And there's so much to talk about race and ballet and how things have changed or how things haven't changed. Mm-hmm. But for you, to what degree are things different now because you have the kind of achieved principal status? Mm-hmm. Do you feel things are different now for you than when you were first a member of the Corps de Ballet or a student? And do you have, are you aware of the baggage of being the first, and therefore you're like the Rosa Parks of ballet, you know, in certain ways. I mean, you and a lot of other important women who went before you, mm-hmm. you're part of a lineage of Rosa Parks, Virginia Johnson, and you know, many, many other ballerinas. But so you're on a continuum. Mm-hmm. But does it give you some? I guess those are two questions. What kind of responsibility do you feel when you step out there on stage, or when you greet these beautiful students from the ARC that you just did earlier? And to what degree are you a role model, and do you have a responsibility? And are things different?
I don't think things are different quite yet. I think that for that generation of students that I just met with, I think that their views are already changing. Just the ability to be able to dream and see a future for yourself has changed. To be able to see me at American Ballet Theatre as a principal dancer, I mean, the the weight that that carries when you can visually see success in someone who looks like you, that goes such a long way. But in the grand scheme of things, I feel like as a Black woman in America and society, no matter what you do in life, I think we have a responsibility. I think that we have to set an example of what it is to be a positive role model, especially when you're a public, you know, person. So I think I've always understood that as a Black woman. So especially as a ballerina, yes, I feel a responsibility to represent in a positive way. But it's difficult. It's difficult to be in this position. I carry this weight proudly, but the negative feedback will never go away, I think, for as long as I live. I don't think racism will ever go away. So I think that it's something that I think being an artist and being a dancer has prepared me for that, because we are used to being criticized and we have to take it. It's what makes us better, and we're in a subjective art form.
I've been in Washington, D.C. for 17 years, 17 and a half now. And when I first moved here and I accepted the directorship at the Washington Ballet, I was very aware that the Washington Ballet had a very white past, and that our art form was a white art form, thought about as a white art form. I also knew that for the Washington Ballet to survive and for our art form to survive, that it had to reflect contemporary, the city in which we live and work. And I knew that was going to be important on multiple levels. It means that the dancers had to reflect what the city looked like, and it took us a long time to build that. Our school had to reflect what the city looked like, and the repertoire had to reflect the culture of the city. Mm-hmm. And one of the first projects I did was with Sweet Honey and the Rock. Sweet Honey wrote, for those who don't know, Sweet Honey is a legendary a cappella group, musical group, African-American women, grew out of the civil rights movement, but just amazing, amazing group. They created an hour-long score, and I directed and choreographed the ballet, and the visual artist Sam Gilliam, the most dean of the Washington Color School, most important African-American visual artist that has ever come out of Washington, D.C., designed 31 original art pieces for a set. And then Sweet Honey and Washington Ballet went on tour for six weeks around the country performing together. And Bernice Regan, who founded Sweet Honey, and I had a talk back after every show.
Wow.
This was, you know, I just started my second year at Washington Ballet, and the company had one African-American man and no African-American women. And I got the same question after every show in every city, from Arizona to New York to Seattle, Washington. The first question, I always got the first question, not Bernice, and the first question was some version of the following. Septime, the presence of these strong women of color on your stage merely underscore the absence of Black ballerinas in your company. Can you tell us why? That was the same question, and I hadn't thought to expect that question, but the first night on tour, I just blurted out, well, it's not something I'm proud of. It's something I want to change and I'm working to change, but I think it won't be changeable until the great ballet training academies are welcoming places for young girls of color. Mm-hmm. And their parents think that they are safe places for their girls and boys to be training. Mm-hmm. And in fact, that was one of the inspirations for me working so hard to found Washington Ballet at the Arc with all these young girls. Did you find your early years, I know that you started a little later than usual. Can you talk about what it was like to be African-American in ballet in your youth?
I think I had a very interesting introduction to ballet, and the environment that I was in was very diverse. I grew up in Southern California in a small town, but it was very diverse. So being African American, my mother made sure that I understood that I was biracial, but I was going to be seen by the world, by society as a Black woman. So I feel like I really had a real grasp on that. But when I stepped into the ballet studio, it was a completely different world. I feel like I didn't connect the two. My real world, which was a lot of poverty, a lot of struggling to just survive. And so when I went into the ballet world, it was this fantasy. It was the first time I was a part of something where I could be free. I felt beautiful. I felt like I had a voice. I could express myself in a way that connected with me. So the fact that I was the only Black girl in almost every, you know, studio, every class, that never really even entered my mind, because I was in this bubble of like love that I'd never experienced. It wasn't until, well, actually it had been brought to my attention maybe around the age of 15, but I didn't really understand it. Not, you know, being in a school that was so diverse, I couldn't really conceive of that, like being the only one. It wasn't until I became a professional that I, you know, was growing up and understanding how the world worked, and I was living in New York City, and I think it's very interesting because New York was so diverse, and then I would step into ABT and I was the only Black woman, and there were 80 dancers, and that went on for 10 years. And so I think that's when it really hit me, and I started to understand the power I held. I think initially it was like, what am I doing here? This isn't for me. I don't know if I'm ever going to make it beyond the court of ballet. But then I felt like having such incredible mentors and Black dancers and Black women that came into my life that helped me to understand the bigger picture is what gave me the power.
And did you feel like an outsider? And to what degree? I mean, so many artists have talked about being an outsider has fueled who they are,
yeah,
and allowed them to show the mirror up to the world.
Right.
Is that part of who you are,
absolutely,
being the outsider?
Absolutely. I think in the beginning, you know, being a 17-year-old, 19-year-old girl, I think my first reaction was to rebel. It was like, I don't fit in here. I'm going to do everything they're telling me not to do. You know, I felt like, you know, I went through puberty late in life, like a lot of dancers do, being so active. And by the time I was 19 years old, I was already a professional dancer. My body started to change, and I was being told, you know, to lose weight, and my breasts were too big. And I feel like I connected all of those things with being African American. And it was like, you don't like me because I'm Black. You don't like my body because it's Black. And I feel like in the beginning, that was this very negative thing over me. Mm-hmm. And in time, I feel like, yes, it fueled me feeling like an outsider. It was like, I want these little girls that come up to me and dancers in other companies that say, you know, they don't know how to talk to me. They don't know how to tell me how to do my hair. They don't know how to work with this kind of hair. You know, all of these things that are simple things, you know, in a Black household or anyone's household, you should know how to talk to someone who's different from you. And I felt like we have to educate people. I don't think that everyone is racist and everyone is out to, you know, against these dancers, but we need to find a way to educate everyone.
I think that you dancing in Swan Lake this week at the Kennedy Center is to some degree a political act. And I also think your willingness to tell your story is very generous of you, but it's also political in a good kind of way. And I know that we artists contribute to the body politic in different kinds of ways. And it, for you, talking about who you are in an honest and candid way, and letting now everyone else kind of connect the dots, mm-hmm, about what the significance is a political way. So I find hearing you talk about your story really powerful. I also felt reading your your memoir that you published a couple of years ago, really, really moving. And I wonder if you would indulge us to read a little bit about your early life.
I guess should I set it up a little bit,
please,
so they're not like, what is she talking about?
Sure.
Yeah, I know. I think it's important, as you were telling me before, that you know, a lot of people see the success of me and maybe haven't followed my story from the beginning. And I think it's important for people to know that it's been a lifetime of sacrifice and work, like every dancer experiences, and that this is not just something that, you know, happens. I wasn't like discovered in Hollywood and overnight I, you know, became a star or something.
Sure.
Anyways, so I just wanted to go back to probably one of the most difficult times in my childhood. It was maybe a couple of months after I discovered ballet at my Boys and Girls Club on a basketball court where the free class was being given. I was 13 years old, and this was at a very critical time when I had just been told by my mother that we just couldn't handle the back and forth between the studio and home, where we were living in a motel at the time. So she told me I was going to have to quit dancing. I opened the car door and got in beside her. "I'm going to have to stop dancing," I blurted out before breaking down into tears. "My mother says that the studio is too far, that it's too much, that I'm missing out on time with my family and friends." Perhaps she would have been better able to understand if, like many concerned parents of ballerinas, my mother had been worried about my struggling schoolwork or fatigue, but this excuse seemed flimsy even to me. Cindy, who's my ballet teacher, looked as though she'd forgotten how to breathe. Her eyes were wide and glistening. We sat there for a few minutes silent. "Well then," she finally said, "at least I can drive you home." I was too tired to protest, too grief-stricken to guard my secret. I gave her my address. We were quiet in the car. I tried to imagine what would fill the space that ballet had occupied, and I kept coming up empty. Finally, Cindy pulled to a stop, staring at the rundown motel where my family was living. She looked as stunned as she had when I told her that I couldn't dance with her anymore. "Thanks for the ride," I whispered as I hurried out of the car. Upstairs, I fumbled for the room key and entered the living room, blankets rolled up near the spots where they would later be unfurled as makeshift beds. I'm sure Mommy didn't believe she was being neglectful. After all, we hadn't always lived that way, with pallets on the floor. We hadn't always called a motel with a lobby window to slide our rent check through home. We didn't always sleep around the corner from a highway lined with liquor stores and sketchy taco joints. But that's how we lived now. That's what Cindy saw. There was a knock on the door. Mommy, who'd been in the bedroom with Alex, came out and opened it. Cindy stood there tentatively. I could feel the tension building in the small space, a nearly tangible thing. I just wanted to disappear. She met my eyes where I sat withdrawn on the floor. I believe that she knew this was it. She either brought me with her that night and into the world she believed I was born to be a part of, or I would never dance again. The two women huddled a while, talking softly, crying too. Mommy made it very clear that she had five other children. I was not, nor could I be, the center of her universe. I knew that, but I needed to be that to someone. "I can't leave her," Cindy said, tears streaming down her face. "I want Misty to come live with me." Then Mommy sighed and looked around the crowded motel room, and she let me go.
That's really powerful, Misty. I know that, I guess it's not the epilogue, because we're enjoying the epilogue now, this, you know, the life that you have shared with us now. But I know that that was part of a really difficult time, mm-hmm. and ultimately led to your request for emancipation. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us what that means and what that was like? And does that kind of wound get healed?
No. I mean, I think that I would never take back any of the experiences that I've had. I think that with all of the struggles and the obstacles I've had as a child and throughout my training and my career have made me such a strong person and dancer and a fighter on and off the stage. That night I went and I moved in with my ballet teacher, and I ended up living with her for about 3 years, where I got the bulk of my training. I trained for 4 years before I became a professional dancer with American Ballet Theatre. During that time, it was more and more difficult for my mother to have me away from home. And I mean, I was dancing every single day. I was homeschooled so that I could catch up on all the training that I missed starting at 13 years old. And she wanted to bring me home, and it was my understanding that I would no longer dance, and it was like, this can't be, I can't go back to the life that I was living and not see a future for myself. And my teacher thought it was best that I would emancipate myself from my mother so that I would be in charge of everything. I wouldn't have to live under her roof, and I would be in charge of my future and my education. And it ended up causing quite a big stir, and it was all over the media, which was my biggest nightmare. I was very, very shy, and the only attention I wanted was when I was on the stage and didn't have to speak. And I ended up moving back home with my mother. We ended up retracting it, and and I went to another school. But no, I don't think that's a wound that can ever be completely healed. But, and I don't think any 15-year-old should ever have to go through something like that. But again, I feel like I can get through Swan Lake because of something.
You're a fighter, that's for sure. That's for sure. Speaking of fighting and willing and wanting, I want to change topics. And it just seems like, as someone who's watched your career for some time, there must be a real tension between the ballerina who you are, and I know that means the dailiness of it. I mean, this morning you got your ASS to class, and I know what it means. It means not drinking and to bed early, and there's a dailiness to it.
Yeah.
And also all of the other things that are in your life, those wonderful opportunities that we know about.
Mm-hmm.
And is it tough to be you? And how do you keep committed to the dailiness of what the art form demands, but also be as damn glamorous as you are?
I just feel like I wake up every single day, even on the days where I'm exhausted and I'm like, I can't do this. I'm just so grateful for the opportunities that I have, for the life that I have, that I'm a professional working dancer. Not many people have that opportunity.
Sure.
So ballet is always first and foremost, and every brand that I'm attached to, that's the first thing they understand, and they learn that there's not going to be a 6 a.m. shoot because I have to take ballet class before.
Sure.
So that is a big adjustment for a lot of brands that aren't used to working that way. But again, that's first and foremost, and everything else in my personal life, I feel like I sacrifice because I understand what this time means for me, and it's not going to be forever that I can be a professional dancer and have all of these opportunities to be seen by the world beyond the ballet world, for people to learn about what ballet is, for people to see a black ballerina on television in a sports ad. So I understand the importance of it all, and I'm tired a lot. But it's not going to be forever, so
sure.
I'm just trying to take advantage of every opportunity while I have it. Every opportunity that makes sense to me and I can relate to, and that's a positive message.
Okay, so now a little round robin about some specifics. Under Armour, that's you've been attached to quite a number of brands, but that seems to, I know it didn't start at all, but it seemed to
mm-hmm.
be the tipping point.
Absolutely.
Was that shoot fun of the... I will it, I want it. Was it fun? And was it fun for it to explode like that? I mean, you went viral like, so, it was so fast.
I don't think, I mean, even Kevin Plank, the CEO of Under Armour, I think he was even...
Who was a neighbor.
Yeah, yes, who was a neighbor in Baltimore. He, I think, was even a little tentative about bringing me on, but his team was, convincing him that this is what sports brands need. They need to see a dancer as an athlete and a strong black woman in this position. So going into that commercial, it was, I think everyone was a little like, I don't know what this is going to turn out like. And of course, with my schedule, I think I was in the middle of preparing to go to Tokyo, like in a couple of days, and I was doing the part of the mistress in Manon for the first time. So it was a very intense time in the studio. So my manager let them know, you have one day to film this commercial, which they're not used, they're used to having a week and a couple of days with their athletes. And that's usually how my shoots go. It's like an all day thing. And I don't like to take breaks. And so the crew hate me because
sure.
I'm like, no lunch breaks. We're working straight through. It was not that fun, 10 hours later. When I first got to the set, I remember bursting into tears, just like, I can't believe that this is happening for me.
Sure.
And it was very emotional. I brought Marcelo Gomez with me, who's a principal dancer with American Ballet Theater, and he also choreographs, and so he was there with me the whole day. He created the movement and tweaked it there on the set,
mm-hmm.
so... it was a very intense day, and they will, I'm lucky to have the manager that I have because they will, use you until you are dead. And, she was literally like pulling me off the set, like, no more.
And what about the Under Armour swag? Do you have a lot?
I do. It's too much. I mean, I give a lot of it away to a lot of the organizations that I'm a part of. I will send to Africa. Mind Leaps is an amazing organization that I'm a part of. But the girls in the dressing room at ABT are always really excited when I come in with a bag. And I just like leave it, and they're like, ah, like vultures.
Okay, I want to hear. Someone here has who has the Mattel Barbie? Can you stand it? Can we take a look at it? All right. I was so excited when the Mattel Barbie, when Misty showed Mattel Barbie. Misty is the Firebird. Tell us about that. Were you involved in the design? Like,
yeah.
How did that happen?
They called me into their offices in California, which was really exciting because I played with Barbies until my mom was like, "You really need to stop. Like, it's not okay. It's not okay anymore." I was a late bloomer,
well, like
I said before. Like last year, no. I think I was like 14, and she was like, "Okay, like I think it's time that you like give it up." So I mean, I had a real attachment to Barbie. I owned so many things, and to be able to like dream and fantasize through this woman that could be anything, any career she wanted, and I think that's such an impactful thing for a young girl to own and to see as a possibility through this
sure.
very symbolic Barbie, the icon. So yeah, I met with them and they just kind of were throwing ideas around, and I meet with a lot of people and I'm like, oh, that's so awesome, but it probably won't ever happen. So when they said, yeah, we're gonna do it and we love the idea, you know, with your book, The Firebird, and having had that really be a role that defined and I think made American Ballet Theatre see me as a principal dancer, so it just meant so much. And then we got to work, and I was like, I want her to look like me. I want her body to be real. I don't want it to be the ballerina Barbie body, which is no breasts and really thin. And I said, I want her to have muscles. So they reconstructed and made the Barbie like they never had before. Right. And they made joints and things that move, and she has like quads and calves, and it's really cool. And you know, they worked. I kept coming back to them like, her boobs aren't big enough. I think they ended up padding that doll because because they brought me like the last prototype and I was like, that's not my body. And then they padded the costume, I think.
That's so amazing. Well, two things. One is that Misty knows that I love a lot about Misty, but my favorite feature is her hyperextended knees. And they're just gorgeous. There's like this crazy S, and I'm happy to see that Barbie has hyperextended knees. But you mentioned Firebird, the book.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Firebird, you created the amazing role with Rhett Mansky's mm-hmm. new Firebird some years ago. And so the first book was the memoir.
Yes.
Which is still available at Amazon.com. And Firebird is a beautiful story for young people about essentially a ballerina of color.
Yeah.
But I know that you have a new book that's coming out. Can
yes.
you talk about it?
Yes. It's called Ballerina Body. And it's a way, I think, for women to view themselves as beautiful and unique and not try and transform and be something else or someone else. And it's giving women an opportunity to create their own version of a ballerina body, a healthy, athletic image. And I think it's great because so many people don't relate the two when they think of a ballerina and her body. They think, oh, she doesn't eat, or you know, she's malnourished, all of these things. And so I kind of want to like get rid of all of those stereotypes. So I cook a lot, so I share a lot of my recipes in the book, and I've helped to, it's loosely based around the ballet technique, but also around floor bar, which is something I discovered when I was going through a serious injury of mine. But to try and get real women who maybe have never danced in their lives a way to use the ballet technique as a physical form of working out that can create long, lean muscles and make them strong. And then just different words I live by, sharing pieces of my story.
And what's your go-to having guests for dinner, menu that you'll cook?
Well, I stopped eating meat a while back, so I'm a pescatarian. I eat seafood. I'll probably do like a citrus salmon and maybe like a cauliflower mash.
2016 was a tough year in lots of ways. Mm-hmm. And we lost a lot of important people. And one of the people we lost was Prince.
Yeah.
And I wanted to ask you about your experiences working with Prince.
Mm-hmm. I feel like the time that I was working with him when I first met him was really the beginning of me like discovering who I was, really starting to step outside of my comfort zone as an artist, and he really pushed me in that direction. I think I'd been a soloist for maybe 4 years at the time when he reached out to me and asked me to be in a music video of his. And I was like, this is strange. Like, how does he even know who I am? But he was a voice that, you know, an artist that I respected and had so much success. And for him to say to me, it's okay to be different. You don't have to follow all the rules. You can make your own rules. And hearing all of that coming from the ballet world was like, what? There's no rules? And, you know, to be able to go on stage with him. And in the beginning, I did a lot of improv. You know, he invited me to tour with him through France. And he literally would just put on, you know, he would have the band playing different songs of his, and I would just go out there and improv and leave the stage when he came on, or dance with him while he was on stage. And the relationship just grew. I think it was like maybe 5 years that we worked together. Wow. Performing around the United States. I did some shows with him, and I just feel like I grew immensely in the time that we spent together, just being able to stand next to and see how humble he is in his real life. And he's not, you know, the prince that everyone assumes he is, and how open and caring and loving he was. So it was a huge loss. Mm-hmm. for me and for everyone in the world.
Sure, of course. I am fascinated by your upcoming film project. Will you talk about it?
Yes. Yeah, it's pretty awesome. So there's a new Disney film that's coming out. It's called The Nutcracker in the Four Realms. It's got like this crazy A-list actor. Like,
Who else is in it?
Morgan Freeman is playing Drosselmeyer. Keira Knightley is playing the Sugar Plum Fairy. Helen Mirren is playing someone bad. I think it's not the ballet story. It's based off of the book. I think she's playing Mother Ginger, who's like a naughty character. And so they had written the script and realized, like, we can't not have ballet in this. You know, like, everyone knows the Nutcracker is the ballet. So they asked me to come in and do the dance sequence. So there's one big dance sequence where it ties in all of the different characters. And I'm the, what is she called? Some kind of princess that comes in and brings all the worlds of snow and the battle with the rats and Waltz of the Flowers and everyone together. And I danced with Sergei, how do you say his last name? The big famous Russian dancer,
yeah,
that's the,
yes,
bad boy.
The bad
of
boy.
Ballet. Polonen, is that how you say his last name?
And he did the film.
He has his documentary and the video,
Take Me to Church.
Yes, that one.
You'll need to YouTube that, by the way.
He's incredible. He's
YouTube,
an amazing dancer.
Take Me to Church.
So I filmed the dance sequence for a week in London a couple of months ago, and it's going to come out in 2018, I think, around Christmas time. So it's so exciting, and to be able to be a part of something that, you know, Disney is, you know,
sure.
Disney.
It's pretty amazing. And so I go back to the, you know, I wanted to ask you about these outside projects, because all along I've thought about how there's a tension between accomplishing all of that and essentially keeping that going. Mm-hmm. And in a short window, your career, one's career is a short career. You know, it doesn't last very long, but still being a dancer. And do you find yourself more giddy with expectation that working on that and that's coming out? Or, for example, preparing for Giselle, which you shared with me that you'll be premiering this spring at the Met. How do those upcoming things coexist, and what gets you more tingly?
There's no competition. Like, it's only ballet. Like, it's amazing to to when I see the outcome of these things that I work on, and I can, and I have this thing to hold on to, which I feel like with ballet, especially because, especially in America, we don't really get to film ourselves dancing a lot. So I feel like it's not like a tangible thing we can hold on to, something that you have to really live in the moment and experience as it's happening. I feel like with these other projects, it's something that I'll always have that I can look back on, see an image, see a video. Nothing excites me like going on stage and preparing and being in the studio, getting ready for a role, just knowing all of the history and all of the dancers that have come before me that have done these things. It's such an honor, and I will never, you know, not feel honored to do all of these roles and have the opportunity to do them.
Sure. I wanted to circle back to talk about politics for a second, because we are in Washington, D.C., and the politics of being an artist, actually. Last week, a friend's teenage daughter, eighth grade daughter, and her class came to Washington, D.C. as teen reporters.
Oh, wow.
And they spent 10 days in Washington, D.C. to cover the inauguration, to cover the Women's March, they met with a Supreme Court justice, et cetera, interviewing all sorts of people. And they interviewed me as an artist. And they asked, and at the time, it was about 10 days ago, I suppose, and they, one of the questions they asked me was, did I think that the remarks that Meryl Streep made on the Golden Globe Awards were appropriate? To what degree is it right for an actor to speak about politics in that way, or are they co-opting their celebrity and using their celebrity's gained for one reason and using it for a different purpose? Mm-hmm. Was that correct or not? What would you say? and to what degree does that, do you live that when you're talking about race, or are you politically engaged otherwise today?
I think that being an American celebrity maybe is a very different thing. We have freedom of speech, and I think that American celebrities have always been viewed differently. They hold the power to carry out different messages because of their status. And so I do think it's her right if she believes something and to use her platform to speak about, you know, where are we going as artists in this new world now with the new president. And so I think that it's definitely her prerogative to speak on something that is a part of her. I've never felt like I needed to get involved in anything political, or I feel like I speak on what I truly understand, which is my art form and being a Black person in America and being a Black artist. I definitely stood behind President Obama and was on the President's Council for Health and Fitness and Nutrition. And when it's using these platforms for a positive thing for the arts, I'm all for it. And if that's what he was supporting, then I'm there to support him.
Were you part of the march?
I was, and I was rehearsing.
That's good. That's important. We have some time for you all to ask. I've been asking all the questions. I've been hogging all the time. But we have some time for you all to ask questions of Misty. Yes.
Thank you for a very interesting talk. I am more familiar with the opera world, and I'd like to know if such artists like Leontine Price or Marian Anderson or even Jesse Norman, coming from another art world, obviously separate from ballet but also interrelated, if they were role models, perhaps.
Yeah. I mean, I think as artists, we're inspired and influenced by everything around us. I don't think that it necessarily has to be another art form, but yes. And I didn't grow up in the classical ballet world. I didn't grow up listening to classical music. I didn't hear it until I was 13 years old when I stepped into my first ballet class. So a lot of my inspiration came from pop culture and pop music and things that were around me, I was surrounded by, that I could relate to and connect with. And I used, this person cannot at all hold a candle to the women you just named, but Mariah Carey.
I was about to ask, were you a Mariah Carey girl?
And when I say that, I'm saying it as, you know, a seven-year-old who is biracial, you know, growing up as a biracial girl in America, and to see someone that looks like you succeeding, who has a gift and is sharing it, I feel like that's how a lot of young girls look at me and can see success through them. And those were the people that I was looking up to, people like Prince and Michael Jackson. And it's important, I think, to be able to see someone you can connect to and see yourself through.
Yes.
Do you also find time to date?
I'm so glad you asked.
That's a good question. I'm very lucky that when I first moved to New York City and I went through that time where I was saying I was rebelling a lot against everything they were telling me not to do, and I felt like I'm, you know, 21 years old and I live in New York City. I want to go out and I want to explore, and I met my husband. So I didn't really date a lot. we were just married a couple, like 5 months ago. So.
And he is really hot. He is so hot. Seriously, he is really hot. Yes.
What's your favorite ballet performance since you were like a little kid? What inspired you?
Let's see, to watch, I think Don Quixote. It was the first ballet I ever saw live when I was 15, and I saw ABT in California, and it was Paloma Herrera. She had just been promoted to principal dancer, and Angel Correa was still a soloist, and it will forever stick with me. But to perform, I think Romeo and Juliet.
Actually, you're dancing Don Quixote. That's also entering your repertoire this year.
Yes.
That's fun to see.
For the Kitri. First time, Kitri this
beautiful.
Spring. Yeah.
Beautiful. Yes.
Thank you so much for being here tonight. You're truly an inspiration. My question is on behalf of the young dancers in the room. If there's one piece of advice you'd give them, what would it be? The ones who are training who may or may not want to become professional ballerinas.
Yeah. I think that thank you for saying that, because it's not everyone's goal to become a professional dancer, and it's a very hard life, and very few people really make it, you know, in top companies especially. I think it's important to know that just being involved is going to enrich your lives in incredible ways. Dancers are some of the strongest people, and I think that being able to be a part of an art form that's connecting your cognitive skills and it's awakening the way that your brain relates to your body and hearing music, I think that it makes you a sensitive person. I think that it makes you more caring and open. And I think that you could go on to become anything, and being a dancer will only add to that.
Yes, that's the correct answer.
I truly believe it.
Hi.
Hi.
I can't believe I'm talking to you right now. This is so crazy. My name is Crystal. This is my twin sister, Kelly.
Hi.
You're an incredible inspiration, Dad, so
thank
I just wanted
you.
To put that out there first. Both of us are black women in our professions, and there's very few number of black women in both of our fields. She's a social secretary. I'm a sign language interpreter. And so when we look at you, obviously you're an inspiration, but how do you manage self-care when you deal with the microaggressions of people asking these questions, and you always have to kind of be an advocate for the black community? Like, what do you do to take care of yourself?
I have an amazing supportive husband.
He's also hot. Did I mention that?
I think it's important to have a support system around you and people that you can just be you and let it all out, let your frustrations out. And just because I'm here and I've reached this level of success doesn't mean that I don't still have those frustrations. I don't still deal with those issues and don't get upset when I hear the stories from young dancers that still experience it. But it's important, I think, to be able to talk about it and get it out there and understand how to fix it, understand how to cope with it, and how to continue to spread the message of just going beyond the color lines. And I get really worked up about it sometimes. but it's important for me to just stay positive and stay on track and continue to just keep speaking, because there's always going to be someone who hasn't heard what I've said before. And it's a part of me. It's not something that I ever get sick of when people are like, oh, you've already told that story so many times. I'm like, but someone hasn't heard it, you know, and it's affecting them. It could affect them in a positive way.
Nice. Couple more questions. Yes, young lady.
Has there ever been a time in your like ballet career where you wanted to stop dancing or like just pause?
Yeah. It happens. I think one of the hardest times, it was actually right before I was promoted to soloist, and I just felt like I didn't belong at ABT. I don't think I was really aware of the lack of diversity throughout the history in ABT in particular, which really kind of scared me. Like, do I have a future here? I think some random guy, you know, they have donors and people that give money that will come into the studios every so often, and they'll get to watch rehearsals in the studios and go from studio to studio and see all the dancers. And someone came up to me and he said, just so you know, there's never been a black woman that's been a principal dancer here. And I think only two have been soloists throughout the 70, or at the time it was like, I don't know, 65-year history. And it was kind of like, what am I doing here? And that was one of the times that Arthur Mitchell came into my life and was such a huge support. I remember I went to Dance Theater of Harlem and I took company class and I sat with him in his office and I was just like, I don't know what to do. And he was like, you can come here and be a soloist. And, you know, and it made me think a lot about what I wanted to do, and I definitely considered taking him up on his offer. I even considered going to New York City Ballet, and they're not very diverse. I don't know what I was thinking there. But you know, I was considering all these things because I just felt like maybe I don't have a future here. And I think speaking to Arthur, it made me really come back to what I really want and what will really make me happy, and that was staying at ABT and fighting for change and knowing that I could continue to work and become a better dancer. And so I think he was one of the people that convinced me to stay.
I was always struck that during the, I mean, you being promoted, there was a big question, or it was talked about a lot, actually. Will Misty be a principal? Will Misty become a principal dancer? It was actually something talked about publicly more than I've encountered. I can't remember hearing talk of that sort. And I thought it was exciting. And I was glad, in a way, that the conversation happened that led up to it.
Yeah.
Did you find, I mean, do you think that there was a good to have had to wait that way, or at least have had to gone through the conversation? And I felt it was really, I was proud of you stating so clearly what your goals were. Mm-hmm. Because your goals became the country's, or your goals became our goals, mm-hmm. those who were supporting you and cheering you on.
Yeah.
Because you were candid about your goal to be the first, or to be a principal dancer at ABT, which by definition made you the first African-American principal mm-hmm. dancer.
There are so many mixed feelings that came with that. Like, I never really thought that things would end up the way they are, that my voice would be heard by so many people. You know, I was being myself in every opportunity I had. I would speak about the lack of diversity, and I would speak about race, and I would speak about my experiences. I wasn't doing it for any other reason. By the time it got to that point where it was like, will she be this, will she not? It was really overwhelming. And then I feel like things kind of got blurred, and you know, and then people think, oh, well, then she was promoted because of this, the conversation, and they felt they had to. And so all of these things, it's a lot to consider and that I'm, you know, experiencing. And I just tried to like shut my ears to all of it and just continue to work and know that I'm one dancer in this big corporation, really, and that I shouldn't be any more important than the girl next to me, and I'm going to continue to work hard, and if it took me 10 years longer than most principals, then that's what it's going to be. But I've just tried to like not get caught up in all of it.
Well, it's exciting that it's happened for you, but it was also exciting to have an important conversation begin to be had.
Right.
You know, 15 years after I had that conversation.
Right, exactly.
You know, it just something that wasn't being talked about.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to wrap up, but I wonder if you might be able to, well, we have one or two, we'll take a question or two. But I do wonder, will you talk a little bit about change and if it's going to happen and in what way, specifically about the world of ballet mm-hmm. and it becoming a more welcoming place for dancers of color.
Yeah, I think that this is a conversation that's been going on for a long time. It just hasn't reached a broader audience. And I think that's what's different now, is that it's reaching people outside of the ballet world. I feel like the focus on me and the focus on race has forced a lot of these big companies and schools to have to make change because people are looking at them now. I feel like that really is what's changed. I don't think it's maybe people's mindset or ideals in the classical ballet world. I just feel like they're being forced to do it, which I think is a good thing. I do think that things are changing again for a young brown girl to be able to see this as a possible future for her, for their parents to feel that, okay, there has been success, so I will put my child in ballet classes. That is a huge step in the way that people view, you know, diversity in classical ballet.
Your ascendancy in collective pop psyche seemed to correspond with some really, really challenging moments in American history of, you know, a couple of years ago. Were you like the good an easy way for people to feel? I mean, we're talking about race. It's so much more pleasant to talk about you and race than some of the other things that were happening in the country. Mm-hmm. You, in a way, provided something, a way to talk about race and it be beautiful in mm-hmm. a certain ways when other things seem so ugly. Is that, do you feel like you've contributed in that way, or what, does that play in?
I hope so. It's a positive story.
Sure.
And I don't know, it's difficult. I also feel like it's, when it comes to art, you know, people tend to kind of maybe not think of you as a black woman or a black person. They just see beauty or they hear music and they don't really relate the two,
sure.
Which could be good or bad. But I think it's important to have beauty and to have art in a world that we're living in today, and to be a black woman and be part of it in a positive way.
Sure. One last question. Anne.
Oh. You put a very pretty face on courage, because what you've talked about this whole evening takes a lot of courage. And I'm also sort of wondering, you seem so grounded, how do you stay positive? Because you've made seem easy almost all some really difficult life experiences.
I think I stay positive again because I have amazing people around me that remind me of my purpose. I definitely have times when I'm like, is it all worth it? Has it changed anything? Like, have all my efforts, you know, when something bad happens in the world, I'm like, is it worth it? And I have people that are like, yes, look at this person that you helped, or you changed the way they view, you know, black people in the ballet world. And of course, there are times when I don't feel strong, but I feel like I just have to keep going every day because someone's going to be affected in a positive way, and it can be really difficult. I mean, I know that there are people in the ballet world that still feel like I don't belong. I read their blogs, I read the reviews, I read racist comments, and it seeps in sometimes, but I just have to continue to think of the bigger picture, the bigger thing that I represent, and the positivity that it will continue to bring to the ballet world.
Tomorrow morning, I am going to eat some Dannon yogurt wearing my Under Armour while playing with my Barbie, my Misty Copeland Barbie, and go online, buy your new book. And get tickets to see you in Don Quixote and Giselle at the Met this spring. Misty, it's been so, so wonderful to have you here. I know that everyone here appreciates your presence here tonight. We know that you kept us waiting, but you were worth the wait. And it's just been an honor to have you here with us tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, please, let's thank Misty Copeland. I imagine. I think your shows are probably sold out. Your Swan Lakes, but actually, when you could get them on the scalping site. You got the scowling sight. But really, thank you very much. I know Misty's got to go to get some rest, because Swan Lake is hard. It's those effing fuetes. But please join us. Please stay and mingle. And we have a reception. So thanks, everyone,
thank
for coming.
You so much.
Thank you, Misty.